I think it's fair to say that the concept of a smart city is still somewhat fuzzy to most of us. We know it has something to do with IT, something to do with the internet, and e-government, and probably even iPad. But if we take this perspective, that cities has been around for thousands of years. The very first city in the world, Jericho, is 10,000 BC, I was told. And ICT has only entered the equation in the last 30 years. So I think we still have a very long way to go, and that probably explains why we're still in this very fuzzy mode. And I thought to talk about smart cities, we probably have to talk about cities first. And that's why the first two parts of my talk will be on cities. And I must also admit that I know more about cities than smart cities. I spent a large part of my career working in a city planner in Singapore. And now I'm in this smart city world, we have to learn about the smart city language. First, a relatively easy question. Why do cities matter? I think most of you have probably heard about the term that more than half of the world live in cities today. I just want to show you this picture, which gives a more stark and tangible feel of what urbanization is about. The numbers you see are the population growth per hour across the world. The bigger the number, the faster the growth. I mean, from this picture, you could see that most of the developing worlds, whether it's in Africa, in Asia, even in South America, cities are growing rapidly. 53 persons in Lagos per hour, that's an amazing number. But you look at the rest of the world, in Europe, in North Asia, in Japan, parts of North America, the numbers are tapering off. And this is quite typical of mature countries around the world. This slide here shows you and gives you a sense of the scale and the pace that we are talking about. In China, we will have 221 cities with more than 1 million people by 2025. As a good measure, we have 35 in Europe today. That's six times more we're talking about. And one example which I like very much is the Shanghai Metro. In 1995, they have one line, 16 kilometers. And now, 420 kilometers. The speed and scale is really amazing. In Singapore, we built about one new MRT line or metro line every 5 or 6 years, and we thought we're not doing too bad. But in China, they are probably building the same in one city, one line a year. And that's the kind of speed we're talking about. Well, you look at the cars, which is the best example, 2.5 million back in 1985, 220 million in year 2020. That's about the same size of the population of US. Imagine that number of cars in a city. How can China cope? I think regardless of whether we are talking about fast-growing cities like China or in Europe, where it's a little bit slower, cities have always been the center of power, economic, social growth. What attracts people to cities is the hope that cities bring, a better life, economic opportunities, and so on. And I think it's important for all of us, stakeholders in cities, to keep this growth alive, keep this hope alive. And at the same time, cities have to manage their push factor. These are the pollution, the congestion, crime, discrimination even. And I think against managing these pull and push factors, the third point which I would like to say, which is also mentioned by Paul earlier, is the need for cities to reinvent themselves constantly. We heard about how Birmingham was the workshop of the world. And now, of course, all the workshops have moved to China. So what is next? How do you reinvent yourself? How do you keep yourself relevant? Find a space that you can occupy, so that you could make yourself useful to the world, to your country, and so on. So these are the issues that city stakeholders have to grapple with. Now, I put in this slide not because this heading says Singapore, but the point here is that the cities that will succeed are the cities that will attract the best talents. In this interesting poll, a survey was done asking the people in the countries, those who want to live the countries, and those who want to come into the country. And the result of the poll, population in Singapore, in New Zealand, and in Saudi Arabia would more than triple. Well, for Singapore, I guess it stands in the world as a good economic place. For New Zealand, I guess because of the quality of life, clean air, green environment. Saudi Arabia, because of the petrodollars. But regardless of the reasons, the point is this. Cities have to attract the best talents in order for them to survive, in order for them to compete, and I would say that this is one of the most key issues for cities going forward. Of course, there are climate change, there's demographic change, but this attraction of talents is probably the most important reason that cities must compete in the years ahead. Now, very well, so we know cities have to compete. And the second question is, how do we then make cities attractive and livable? How do we want to attract all these talents to your city so that you can compete with the best in the world? Well, I pull out this ranking from Wikipedia. Basically, there are numerous rankings done by The Economist, by Mercer, about the top cities in the world. And you could see from this that most of them are around Europe, which where all of you guys stay, with some representation from Canada, from Australian cities. Now, very well, and a lot of cities I know are now taking such rankings very seriously as you benchmark yourself, as you compete among yourself. But I will take such ranking with a pinch of salt, because really, is it possible to compare a city like Munich, 1 to 2 million people, and a city like Tokyo, 10, 20 million people? So when you take a look at all this ranking, do take it a pinch of salt. I don't think you need to be too concerned whether you're third or the fourth about the details, but more or less roughly where you stand. Now, I'd like to use this slide by the Gallup group in US to explain a little bit, to boil down to the details on what do we make a city attractive and livable. In this very simple S-curve, in case the guys behind can't see, there are 9 frame conditions which Gallup say are necessary for a society and for a city to be attractive and livable. The first basic condition is law and order. This is intuitive. If your residents are always living in fear for their own life, then there will be no progress. The second factor is food and shelter. And these are the two, food and shelter are the two most basic material needs that the city would need to have. They come in second because in some part, they depend on the presence of law and order in order for you to have food and shelter. And the third factor is work. Now, everyone wants a good job. And whereas the first two conditions has to do with basic survival, self-preservation, work is where it turns the corner. Work is where you start to think about the ability to uplift yourself, to climb up the social ladder, to have a better quality of life for yourself and for your family. The fourth part of the equation is economics. Now, this refers to the perception, the confidence you have in your economy. Now, this is important because you can't have an army of workers but no entrepreneurs. Someone who's willing to take the risk, someone who feels confident enough about your own economy that you want to start something new, generate work, generate employment, so that everyone would have a good life. The next factor is health. Now, this is very clear. Good health has to do with vibrant places. It's also very important for productive society. Now, if cities and societies can get all these first five basic conditions right, then more or less they are well on their way. The next two are probably a bit more intangible, but these are the next two that probably makes the difference between a normal city and a good one. Well-being. What do we mean by well-being? This is a very subjective term, but it has to do with whether a person is feeling suffering, thriving, whether he's feeling inspirational. And this lays down the basics for creativity in a society. And we all know that you need creativity to give your cities the next leg up. The next one is engage citizens. The previous conditions has all to do with the individual, whether it's work, law and order, food and shelter. For engaged citizen, it brings beyond the individual to the connections between the individuals, to others, and to the community. And when you have a situation where a city feels engaged, where the people feel they have a stake in the city, then you have achieved at a higher order city or society. And along with engaged citizens, you also create a more welcoming environment of talents, where people feel attracted, where there's this sense of acceptance and creativity, and that's where you get to the eighth condition, brain gain. And this is the way I talk about the attraction of talents, where you have this huge pool of rejuvenation of people coming in, make your cities alive, be creative, have new economy, and come up with new jobs for your people. And ultimately, a higher GDP, I guess, is where all of us want to go to. Now, you may ask then, how does ICT play a role? Where does smart city come in? Well, if you expect me to say ICT is the key to achieving attractive, I'm sorry, it's not. To me, good governance is the key driver. Now, I come to Europe, I read about the newspaper austerity drive in Germany, budget cuts in the UK, and it all gets a bit negative, I guess, to the public servants. I think it's important for us to revisit. The fact is that the public servants work their socks off to try to create a better future for the cities and for the country. We must always remember that governors take the leadership, they create the frame conditions, where there's the right policies, the right regulations, so that the rest of the cities can come along and have a better future. Now, how do we, the next question is then, how do we help government? How can ICT play a role to enable governments to come up with best policies and suitable infrastructure so that cities can thrive? To me, there are two main points how ICT can help. The first is to equip and to provide city with sound intelligence for their policy making. I was in Dubai when I first joined Siemens. I met the person, the CEO of their road traffic authority. And that was the time before the financial crisis, all the cranes are moving, all the infrastructure works are underway in Dubai. And the CEO asked me, I have all these projects going on, all my departments come to me with projects that they want to do, how do I actually keep track of them? How do I actually measure them? How do I make sure that they achieve the results that they are meant to be? I mean, if you don't have the right information, the right intelligence, then government is effectively making policies in the blind. So the need for sound intelligence in policy making, to me, is the number one key factor how ICT can play a role. The second factor is enabling smart infrastructure. You have seen the aqueducts that the Roman Empire has built. They transfer water over great distances. Even the Great Wall in China is an infrastructure, a piece of, well, not so sophisticated, but it works. It's meant as a deterrence from the enemies of China coming in. Today, governments continue to build infrastructure, whether it's roads, housing. Well, they might get a little bit fancy, with like the one in Spain, but more or less, we have come to the age where ICT can enable infrastructure to be smart. Now, when we talk about buildings today, we're no longer talking about shelters, just a home. We're talking about environment, which is comfortable, which is safe, and even sustainable. I just want to show you an example of a smart building concept which Siemens is working on. Here we have a model, a fancy model of a smart building. Now the first thing you would see is that a building is no longer a consumer and just a taker of electricity. In future, it's going to be a generator with PVs on the roof, and there's going to be an intelligent brain within the building, which we call a BAS, which controls all the energy consumption that's coming in and even from the building selling out to the grid. Now, this building, when it's time of low energy consumption, like at the night, would use the electricity from the grid to pump water up to the storage tanks, to work as chillers, so that when the daytime arrives, all the chillers would be full, such that the aircon would be on with very low power consumption. At the same time, it will be connected to the electric cars. Now imagine that you drive your cars into the building, you can discharge your electricity you can sell back the electricity when the costs are high, and you can charge up when the cost is low. And at the same time, it's also connected to the renewable energies, like the wind turbines that we have. So in short, a building in the future will no longer be the same like what we have today, which is merely a consumer, but also a producer, as well as a storage medium for electricity. Now ultimately, it's important for us to have a vision of what is a smart city, even though it's many, many years down the road. To me, a smart city is one where governments is able to draw intelligence down your verticals, whether it's in terms of building, energy, environment, and even have cross-sectoral intelligence across these different sectors so that you can come up with the best policies, the best regulations that fits your city requirements. And at the other end, a smart city is one where the city applications make the infrastructure smart, make it easy for your citizens and for your businesses to live and to expect a high level of standards that's reliable and secure at the same time. And only then can we achieve such a grand vision of a smart city. Now, the last part of the presentation, I just want to share with you some of the work that Siemens has been doing in this world of smart city. Now, in case you guys are not so familiar with Siemens, it's basically a very broad engineering company with a whole spectrum of expertise across city requirements. This comes from port, airports, down to infrastructure like roads, traffic, as well as buildings. Now, Siemens started to go into the world of cities about 3 years ago, and one of the things they did is to set up a competence center, which is sited in Singapore, which is where it comes from. You might ask, why would a German company set up a competence center in Singapore, so far away? But actually, Singapore has a few attributes which makes it attractive. In a way, it's seen as a model city with good governance. It's proactive in terms of ICT adoption, so there are many, many interesting pilots, like smart grids, that's happening in Singapore. At the same time, what they did different is to recruit people from Singapore government, which is like myself, coming to work with the technicians, thousands of technicians that Siemens have. Now, the combination of practitioners who are coming from the city, as well as the engineering knowledge from Siemens, we hope to create innovative solutions that cities will require in the future. The second thing that we did in Singapore is to create what we call the city of the future. Now, all of you know that ICT is a bit of an intangible thing that you can't see. It's very, very hard for decision makers to visualize, to feel, and to see what ICT is all about. So we wanted to bridge this gap, to make it simple, and to have a very intuitive showcase where decision makers, mayors, ministers can come and get to see for themselves what ICT can do for their cities. And the third thing is research. Now, Siemens has commissioned a series of studies since 3 or 4 years ago. The first one starting with mega city challenges, which looks into the issues that cities are facing around the world. It goes down to sustainability infrastructure, which talks about the specific technologies that can help cities achieve their CO2 targets. The last one, which is commissioned by my center, is the ICT for City Management. In this study, we interviewed citizens, businesses, and public sector officials in 15 cities around the world to get their different perspective from the consumer side, that is the citizens and the businesses, and the public sector side, and try to find the differences in opinion and where they are aligned. From here, we can get a lot of intelligence on what is public sectors are doing right, and what are the citizens asking for that the public sector is not doing. Now, this study, I can't bring it today because it's heavy, but I can welcome you to download it from our website. It's available. So with that, I've come to the end of my presentation. I hope you have enjoyed. Thank you.